practices. We really cannot keep up. It's as if he goes on media benders with rallies and Fox interviews and tweets, but we're the ones who can barely stand up straight at the end of the day. So last weekend, several of the country's best-known newspapers tried to study a week of Trump's statements, and all the newsrooms concluded the same thing, that Trump lies more often than Hillary Clinton. Yes, lies. Politico, the New York Times, LA Times, they all used the L word. Trump's whoppers about Iraq and birtherism were a theme at Monday's debate as well. No wonder people doubted him when he complained that the microphone he was using was defective. Now, as it turns out, the debate commission said on Friday there were issues regarding Trump's audio that affected the sound level in the debate hall. It did not affect the TV broadcast, though. This weekend, Trump is taking a truth that there were audio issues and spinning it into a conspiracy theory, musing that the debate commission is rigged against him. Trump keeps telling his followers that every institution is rigged. First the commission, you know, and all these other issues. Well, now even Google.
And a new post-debate poll that just came out, the Google poll, has us leading Hillary Clinton by 2 points nationwide. And that's despite the fact that Google's search engine was suppressing the bad news about Hillary Clinton. How about that? How about that?
In 22 seconds, there were at least two falsehoods. Number one, Google did not conduct a poll. Number two, Google's algorithm is not biased against him. Mr. Trump, just Google Hillary Clinton lies, and you'll see all the stories that Google is not suppressing. So let's dispel with one more Trump myth. In the wee hours of Friday morning, he tweeted his frustration with all the recent stories about his aides telling him to shape up and study for the next debate. He wrote this: anytime you see a story about me or my campaign saying sources said, do not believe it. There are no sources. They are just made-up lies. He says if we don't name our sources, our anonymous sources, who insist on anonymity, the sources don't exist. This is untrue. It's flatly untrue. It's actually really troubling to say because CNN, the New York Times, all these news outlets have really important anonymous source policies where we have to tell our editors, tell our bosses who our sources are, even when they're Trump aides who are trying to communicate with Trump through news stories. Bottom line is these false claims by Trump have serious consequences. Back with me now to talk about it, John Avlon, a CNN political analyst, editor-in-chief of the Daily Beast, and Tim Grant, executive editor of Newsbusters. Tim, I believe your position here is anonymous sources are not acceptable or not appropriate to be using for stories?
Anonymous sources are for important information. When you have information you can't get any other way, what we see too often in political news media today, as I just suggested in the previous segment, is you use anonymous sources to say incredibly nasty things, often from political consultants who have clients they're trying to be friends of. Like, I can't say nasty things about the other Republicans because they might hire me later this year. What you're saying when you're a news source is, trust us, this person does not have an agenda. Well, when the newspaper or the network has a partisan agenda, then you're not going to tend to trust their anonymous sources either.
John, what do you make of Trump telling people not to believe the media? It's been a theme for 15 or 16 months ever since he entered the race, but it seems to be heightening in recent weeks.
Absolutely. Look, I mean, he's been very clear that attacking the media is a core strategy for his campaign. It's been expressed by surrogates like Newt Gingrich and expressed to other surrogates in particular. And Trump has a twisted relationship with the media, right? Because he simultaneously craves media attention and then attacks media when it attempts to hold him accountable, which is our job. Look, I think we also need to confront the fact that part of the reason that Trump's line of attack works for his supporters is that trust in media has been on the decline for decades. And that is a real problem. A culprit of that, I would argue, is the rise of partisan media, which allows people to segregate themselves into separate political realities. But that is a larger and different problem. It is deeply serious. It's the ground on which Trump's success with these line of attacks with his supporters run. But in the long run, it's about trying to diminish the idea of truth itself, and that is incredibly dangerous to democracy. You know, my favorite quote from Daniel Patrick Moynihan: everyone's entitled to their own opinion, but not their own facts. And that's what's being intentionally muddled here by the Republican nominee.
On Monday, after the debate, Donald Trump praised Lester Holt. But later in the week, he had some pretty choice words for the moderator. Let's look at what he said later in the week.
Well, you know, when I first did it, I thought he was fine. I wasn't thinking about it. But when I reviewed it and when I saw all the commentary, because a lot of people thought he was terrible, and I looked at all of the commentary, I realized he was much, much tougher on me than he was on Hillary. It was like a day and night.
Tim, tell me why you think Trump is bringing this up repeatedly. Do you feel that working the refs is a smart strategy for him?
Working the refs is a terrible analogy. If Lester Holt was refereeing a football game, he would have gotten thrown out of the stadium. I think the Saturday Night Live skit I would have done if I was running the show would be Lester Holt. It would sort of be like the end of Top Gun, where he lands on the flight deck after beating the Russians and everybody applauds him. Obviously, the whole news media spent before the debate was telling Lester, Truth Squad Trump, Truth Squad Trump, no Truth Squad Hillary.
And he
heard the lesson. And he obviously did this in a way that was completely one-sided. And everyone knows
it. Lies more than Clinton on the stage.
Correct. But the whole assumption of liberal media is Hillary somehow never lies. Right?
Who's
if you go to PolitiFact, everybody cites PolitiFact and says Hillary never lies. The fact of the matter is, why is her trustworthy level so low? Because people have watched her over decades lie about everything, including, I gasped for air, I had no idea he cheated on me with Monica Lewinsky. Nobody buys that. And for everybody to pretend they do is amazing.
Yeah, a couple things here. You know, PolitiFact's ranking of the lies by respective candidates is as close as we're going to get to an objective tallying of the sheer sum and total. We know that Donald Trump is, at the end of the day, a hype man. He admits freely, engages in hyperbole. The problem is that crosses into demagoguery in a political context. Hillary Clinton has problems with honesty and trustworthiness. We know that from polls, in part because for 25 years she's been demonized by partisan media. And so it comes back to partisan media and the role it plays. It is the job of journalists to insist on a fact-based debate. It is increasingly we are recognizing that it is also our job to call out lies and to call them lies without and not default to this on the one hand or the other moral relativism. And those of you on the side of partisan media who say that, you know, the implicit bias of mainstream media over the years can only be corrected by explicit bias. Well, you carried the day for a while, but now people are hip to your tricks. And it's a fundamental problem that's undercutting trust in media, journalism, and democracy writ large.
Nobody buys this whole pretense that somehow John Avlon and the Daily Beast are the soul of objective media coverage when you sat in the studio and you all made fun of Dick Cheney's heart trouble and how wouldn't take his heart in a transplant.
Go back and look at your own clip, because while you're exquisitely sensitive about things when they're perceived slights, you'll see actually I defended Dick Cheney in that particular clip you're referring to, which is ancient history, but I'm happy to engage in it. Look, the bottom line is that you guys have a real credibility problem, and there's a need for a place like you to call out whatever implicit or explicit bias exists on the left. But you sacrifice your real credibility because you're only going to focus on one side of the problem, and that perpetuates the polarization. We try to be nonpartisan, but not neutral.
We're all focusing on Trump.
And what that means is that we will hit the left or the right as the facts indicate. We will report without fear or favor, and you have explicit favor in your donors and your ideological agenda from day one, and that's why your credibility fails.
Let me play ref here and say I want all media to exist. I want Newsbusters to exist and the Daily Beast. I just want people to know what they are and what they stand for. Gentlemen, thank you both for being here.
Thank you.
And John has written the perfect companion to this segment on CNNMoney.com, his essay, What News Needs to Do Now in These Weeks Ahead of the Election. Check it out, CNNMoney.com.